Yo, 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 what's up YouTube? This your boy Obey Usay. What's up, Records Lair Production, back at you with another tutorial. In this tutorial, we'll be getting into automating out your 6i6. And a couple quick MIDI tips. Working with the MIDI clip and traction and building a SSL model console in your DAW. Alright, let's get into it. Okay, so what we got going on here, we got a project folder. This is the project folder. In the project folder, we have a music folder where all our sounds are at. We have a sub folder where all our subs, each sound is going. Sifts, keys, going to his own sub, drums, other percussions going to their own subs. Then we have a aux folder, which is have a basic left and right delay track, two delay tracks and two reverb tracks, one left, one right for both. And we have a faders folder where we have all our faders in it, where what we call in this project, it's going to be a little different than any other project mix you've seen me show you before. This one is we're using the DAW output. We're calling that a wet output. We're calling that the wet output instead of it calling it dry, because it do have all the mix processes in it. Everything is in it, so it's wet. It got everything in it. It's not dry. But we got all the outputs that's going to the 6i6. And then here's our print folder. And this folder is where we print the tracks from. And we're going to get into that too. So let's jump in first music folder. Okay, so here in the music folder, you will see we got where I created. You can see on this track, bass track, you see it's going into the Nexus. I just recorded this track and then looped it down in the audio file. You can see the way I did this by selecting the bass track as audio input and recorded it. Yeah, I recorded like 15 bars, and then I just end up cutting it back and looping it. Then you got my piano, Nexus, everything that's a sif in here, keys, bass, all is done in Nexus. And our drums is done with the sampler plugin. This basic sample's in there. And let me say some more sounds. So let me move these so we can cut out some confusion. Alright, so that's basically, and then if you've seen my last couple videos, you know about this, what I do on my kick and snare. So you see I only got one track with my hats, and then my hat sample, I got my cymbal, close and a long, and I got my snare, two samples for my snare, and I got a left channel, a right channel, and a center channel, and my center channel is let me see, because I got to do the math on it. So my center channel, I had to take it away because it's both channels, so you had to take that back. So it's 9 dB, so I had to take, even though both of these are negative 3 wouldn't work for this, so I had to take another 3 dB off, compensating for the left and the right side. So this is at 9 dB to make this match equally with the rest of the volume. So that done the same thing with the kick at 9 dB. On my center one. Well, this one at 10, whatever, but it's at, oh shit, I'm fucking up. Alright, okay. Oh nah, but I just had to, it was at 9 dB, but I moved my kick, I turned my kick up some when I used my VU meter to match my bass level. Okay, so then we got the subs folder. And in the subfolder, this is where the magic really started at right here, because you will notice I got my sins on here. Like I say, my sins could have been on the tracks, but that could bring a big delay when you're going into compressors and stuff. But it's okay. Don't worry about that delay if you know you're only doing effects. But me, I like to do bus. I like to do my two busing and stuff off my sins too. So I don't want that delay. But this new way I'm doing it right now, it's going to bring a delay from the DAW in my 6i6. But it's a cool thing that you're getting, because it's going to make me have two mixes at my print. I'm going to have a DAW print and I'm going to have a 6i6 print. And they definitely be different. They be totally different. So, and then what I'm going to do, I'm going to put them two together and do my mix for my, to do my mix, do my mastering off of. I'm going to master off them two files to make a master. Okay, two stereo files. So, here we go. I'm going to basically show you that every channel that got any kind of audio coming out, even if it went through a mini plugin, each one has a white channel on it. So, if you would notice in my subs, I normally have compression and all that. You'll notice I only have an EQ. I don't even have a compressor on my subs. I only have an EQ on my subs. Right? And it's a reason I'm doing this, because I could have put it on there too, but the method and the way I'm doing, when I get the sound that I'm looking for out of the tracks, the way I'm going, like, because I'm really trying to model this after the SSL way, once I get the sound that I'm looking for out of the track, I want that sound to come all the way to the end of the edit, just get this sound better at the end. So I don't want, let me open all the folders up. I don't want to comment. Putting more compressors on alter the sound of audio too. So I don't want to alter the audio from here. Any alteration I want to do, I'm sending it to my two bus for that. So that's what I'm doing. You'll see I got, this is lead to key. These the output. So there's one going to the output, one going to the delay, reverb, one going to the two bus. And this is my sins. So, and on all my sins, you will notice on my buses, they had a negative 6 dB on my bus, on my busing. And then I'm going to show you that I'm slamming my bus, my two bus, I'm slamming it in the plugin. But on my bus channel, you will see I got a plugin. So, let me see. I went back on. And then that's the other thing I wanted to talk about. My last video I had the SSL model going, right? But I kept having a latency issue. And it was basically right here, because when I first had the British channel, you didn't have no late, you couldn't change the latency. So I already knew it was a powerhouse plugin that was gonna take up a lot of CPU. So I just thought of it as that forever on. But then I came to notice that, oh, the latency right here. So when you go turn the low latency on, you can put this on as many tracks as you want. I mean, let me see how many tracks I'm running. And I know it's on almost every track, but probably, we'll say like 6 tracks. It's probably not on, nah, we say 12 tracks or something like that. We got like 34 tracks on it. But I got edit, the last edit that I did, I ended up switching, and it's like 48 tracks on there. But and I got one on at least 40 tracks on that one. It's like 48 tracks, and I got a British channel or a white channel on, and they similar, but they different. And what I would say is, like, if you like the UAD one, then you'll like the white channel in that instance. And the British channel, it sounds just like the SSL, and is, you know, the SSL got that warm, that more of a dark feeling. This one is more open. like the UAD one is, like to me, like the UAD one is more open. So we basically going to show you what I got going on here. And this is my two bus out right here. You can see I got the British, like I say, the British channel on here. And all the rest of them got the white channel. So what I did when I went to my two bus, I ended up going British channel. You can see I'm slamming in and out. I'm slamming this, all that. I'm slamming it. Look, 15 dB, 15 dB, 15 dB. I'm slamming at my my two bus. And then I'm mixing that back in. But what I want to show you is, so you won't get confused when you're using the 6i6. This is also a traction video, and it's definitely a 6i6 video too for what I'm going to show you. So with the 6i6, like as of now, you can see you're listening to me through the SPDIF output, right? And I can switch this and you still gonna hear me, but this gonna be the DAW mix, DAW 1, DAW 2. I'm gonna switch the DAW so you still hear me coming in. Alright, so this the DAW. So now you're listening to me through Traction and not going out from Traction to the 6i6 first. So you'll notice if I mute this. Check. Alright. No, I gotta be in this one. If I be in this one and I mute it. Hold up. Alright, now if I mute this. See, when I mute it, you can't hear me because when I mute it now, if I mute the default output and vocals output, you will see that you can't hear me because you're listening through this signal, and this signal is not getting here until it comes through the DAW, come from out of the DAW into here. So if I mute the DAW, there's no way you're going to hear me here. But I'm going to show you the differences. So if I go back to the DAW 1, we're going to go back to DAW 1, DAW 2, and then we're going to go into the mix. And I'm going to show you that when while we listening to the DAW, anything I'm doing in here will not be heard. Like this right here is changing from stereo to mono channels, making each channel a mono channel. But it still accept, if you were sending a stereo file through each channel, even though it's going in the mono fields, there's something to understand that I had to understand because I tried it in it. When you send it, even though, like, so you got all these channels, so you got 12 channels, right, all together, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and 2 more for this one, 12 channels, right? So you basically got 12 tracks for outputs that you can output with if you want to for each one. All you will have to do is like I did here, so I'm going to show you. You see this one say, aux. This one say aux, two bus, and two bus on the right. So when I'm sending both of them here, you're going to see the bus coming up the right channel and the aux coming up the left channel. So how did I do that is basically here. Down here in the out, you will see on my aux return output, this is going straight. When you see the picture of the 6i6, let you know it's going straight to the 6i6. This, you can see this pan all the way left, and then you will see my two buses pan all the way right. So when it's coming out into the 6i6, the 6i6 recognize that and know to put that on this channel and that on this channel. So it automatically know that this is going to come right. But then what gets so cool is when you hit this stereo button, it still pick up it's still stereo both of them, if you can understand. It's stereo both of them, like the two bus and the aux going to be stereo, but you still gonna have to control your volume. You can move the fader right here, but I don't touch these faders. I just use this for looking purposes, and I do my faders in here. Then you still control your volume from in here for how you want the sound to be coming back out through here. And then, like I said, I got the choice of always going to go check and listen to either one. So when I'm listening to my 6i6 and not from the DAW, I mute this. I make sure I mute the, because what happened is it's sending back a delay because it's coming back twice. I'm sending it back through twice, and I'll also show you that. See my aux fader? You can see this is where my aux is coming to. But then you see I got it sending back out again, aux return, going to my aux return out to go back out to the 6i6 to come to my aux return. So, but this aux fader is going to default output the same place where my wet is going. And that is also where you will see where it say vocals. The same place I'm talking, default output right here. So it'll be coming right here. So I will basically have it. What I've done that for is to make sure that even when I burn my DAW instance of the edit, it will have the aux in it. The aux will be in my DAW instance. Regardless, it's going to be in it. The only thing that won't be in my DAW instance is my 2-bus. My 2-bus will only be in my 6i6 print. I'm only going to be able to get that out of my 6, unless I record it back into, or make a track that's watching this track. See, I can do that too, right, like this. Oh, wow, so it just gave me a number. I did. So what I basically can do is put this track right here, then make this input be the 2-bus fader, and then I'll be able to listen to this. I just had to turn it, keep it on, and then it's going to be bringing in the same level that's already coming from here to here, and then I can just output this one. See, this one is, see, it's outputting to the aux bus out, right? So it's going out. This going straight out. So if I wanted it in the edit, I will have to do this right here, what I'm doing here. But I don't know. Let me give this a test and see what the delay and stuff will be like. So we're going to go and make sure we're listening to the DAW. Yeah, we listen to the DAW right now. So, all right. Now we're going to give this a test and see, do we get any delay from this? We're going to mute. Good thing I did do that, because that just gave me a new thing to notice in the midst of me doing that I need to do. So we're gonna go to this, and we're gonna, instead of panning it, we shouldn't need to pan it once I mono it. So I'm gonna reset this panning back to center. Alright, see, there we go. All right, same thing here. So I'm gonna change this and move this from my ear. So my aux that's going into, this is another reason why I need both of them, because I know different things happen. My aux going into here is going to be my aux going in here gonna be stereo. That's going into back into that wet edit. So it's really gonna be wet. It's gonna have my aux in. It's gonna be wet going in there. It's gonna be stereo. So we're gonna take this and put this back center. Oh, I can't send it. I forgot. This automated. That's automated. All right. So now we got that mono, so we can send it this back. Now let's give it a listen. All right, you'll notice also I have nothing on my wet beta, but I had a VU muted and I turned this off because, like I told you, the delay will come for how I'm running this signal chain. I want the chain to delay down going to my master fader. So this really is only a fader and that's it. It's basically just a point that everything meeting that to go out for me, because I'm never going to even touch it. It's going to be here and stay here and that's it. I'm just a monitoring point. But right here is really where I see what's happening. So we're going to delete these right here. We're going to do a new set. Cause I just did too many changes that is going to be different anyway. So basically, we're going to center these. Center the panel on these. As you will notice, on these, I already got them on. This one ready for the print the DAW. This one ready to print my 6i6. And you see I got a message right here to show me, because I got to say to the template, do not turn up fader. Don't turn these faders up. Probably blow the 6i6 out or something. Because it's looping back. You don't want to play, you don't want to hit the loop back. But what I am doing is monitoring everything from here. So I went and checked, made sure everything right at this point. Because what you always have a problem with, the main problem is, you don't know what your final product gonna sound like or look like. And that's why I love doing it this way right here. This way right here is the best, because you're getting to see the final result. You're looking at it. You're looking at what the final result will look like. You're getting a preview of it from here. Instead of waiting to print out, you're like, man, damn, it was looking like that while I was in the edit, but it came out looking like this. I promise you, what it looked like here when you print it, it's gonna look like that when the printer over too. So like I say, we'll put our meters up right here. So this for each one. The top one is the 6i6. The bottom one is the DAW. And both ones should be running. See, it say live input monitoring on both of them. They both on. And we're going to pull up both VU meters. Right, the top one for the top one, the bottom for the bottom. Same thing for this. So we're going to go ahead and play the track. And we're going to see what kind of difference do we get. And I'm going to show you some difference with me changing settings in the 6i6. So let's move this up some. All right, here we go. You can see they peeking out fairly the same. The perceived volume around pretty the same. say you same. They round about the same, right? All right, so and now this is 6i6. This is the 6i6 meter right here. The one that's moving while I'm talking. So now we gonna go see the difference of the two. What we can do with the differences of the two. Alright, so I'm gonna show you how they can sound different. I'm gonna unmute these real quick. We don't need to change this to watch it. I want you to hear it. Alright, so we're gonna listen to the DAW first since we already right here. Well, let's see the doll, and I want you to hear the difference. All right, this is the doll, and I'm gonna show you that this is the doll right here. Right here, see this fader? I mute it. See? And what you get, the 6i6 still playing back, because the stuff's still going out at the subs point. See? So there's something that you got to know, that even though it's muted, remember, this going to be in the recording. It's at the bottom of the recording. So I can't explain this, right? So you're talking about at down around 20 dB, 40 dB, you got clear music playing, moving left or right at a constant. When you're doing it this way, it's gonna record this in it. So this the good thing of it on the 6i6. This is why the 6i6 will always sound a little bigger than the print version, the regular DAW, when you print it out, because it's getting the DAW coming back in at a low level at all time, because it's coming in, and that's the difference maker. But I'm going to use both of them. I'm going to have a print, and I'm going to mix both of them back in together. So we're going to go back to the 6i6. And now we're going to go to the... the PDIF output. So... I mean input. Show you the differences. Watch the correlation section and listen when I'm changing the stereo fields of the track. And this is a great way, what I wanted to show about the automation part, especially for automating in intros, outros, and bridges. This is a quick, easy way to do it to a beat you already just had made, and you're like, man, you don't feel like going through the whole Jester, gonna go do all that part. You wanna get lazy. So this is what I call lazy automation. So we're gonna do some lazy automation. And this how you'll do it. All right, so there you go. So then, now I'm gonna give you the DAW. We're gonna do the DAW. We're not gonna hear the 6i6. We're gonna mute the channel. As you can see, this do nothing, see? This do nothing now, because this the DAW. You're listening to the DAW. And like I say, you will really need to mix them separate because of the fact that what I'm ready to show you is, if you don't, in the DAW you don't hear it because this never coming back into the DAW, right? With these on, it don't matter, mute or not, none of these tracks are coming back into the DAW. So knowing that they're not coming back into the DAW, right? Knowing that none of these tracks are coming back into the DAW. So when I got DAW selected right here, they're not coming into the DAW. But the good thing is about this is I get to mix in two instances. I get to mix my analog version, what I call it, and I get to mix my digital version, what I call it. And what I understand in my working with it from now is if it sound good in the mono channels, well, so I mix down in here with all my tracks here, because let's go back to the I'm gonna show you the benefit of this. I make sure I go check this. This gotta be happening. So I'm gonna play this again. I'm gonna mute this once I play it because this gonna make a delay, because the DAW is, like I told you, the DAW. I'm gonna let you hear the delay. But oh, it's a sweet delay. Don't get that twisted. Like, it's something that you will end up using in a lot of edits. A lot of edits you end up saying, oh, that sound good. That delay that it naturally give it is good. It's the right amount of timing. Late. So what I will say is I will end up recording a part of this and put into the ending song with the delay on it because it sound good. Let's listen again. Especially here. Alright, but now I'm gonna show you the delay gonna go away when I hit the mute button. But what I'm trying to show you, you ain't gonna be able to hear me, so pay attention. What I'm gonna do, I'm gonna go hit on the stereo fills, and I'm gonna show you what I mean why I go, when I go really wanna mix hard and really clean up, I drop these down to the mono channels and mix down because it widens everything out. It sounds crazy to say mono gonna widen everything out, right? But because it's sending it down in a stereo channel, I don't know. But this is this the greatest, man. Let me just show you what I'm saying. Watch. You can see everything going straight down the line, right? See, I even can go to the default coming in. So it makes the delay don't sound as predominant. But I'm gonna mute it. like I say. So basically, I work at it like this, because like I say, once I know I got it, this one seemed, you know, you hear, ooh, it sound better. Work at it in here. Yeah. You can work at it in here, too. I mean, I'm going to tell you it's no backwards way, but this to me, it's easy to work at it when they in the field this way. In the mono way, it's easy to work at it, because like I say, once I know I got it sounding musical with it, sounding spread it out, I know it did something about it. Once I mesh them, they mesh good every time. I ain't had a problem yet. So now we getting ready to record it, and we're going to throw in some automation on the what you call them track, the 6i6 track, print track. We're going to print both. We're going to print the DAW track and the 6i6 track. And one thing you want to remember when you're doing this with the 6i6 is you want to definitely, like I say, mute this. What you're doing while you're doing your automation part, because you don't want that in your print because it's coming back late, or until you want to put it in. Like, I'm gonna mute it, and like I told you, I'm gonna use it for certain parts. So all I do is just cut it back on to come in. It's gonna come in where I wanted to come in at, right? To do what I would do it when I wanted to do it. So like I say, you still gonna have times when you want to use it, but you can just print back the DAW mix, and then they're gonna be that timing, they're going to be off in the field when they get on the edit screen too. So I'm going to show you how to go back and just line them up right. Once you line them up proper, and you're good to go. So here we go. Let's go ahead and record and throw in some automation. I stop because if I want to work that right where it worked right to me, I would have to go turn the fader down on the output fader of the DAW for me to print that in right now in this go of the instance. Only way I can get it in this go of the instance is to bring it in, not I would have to bring it in, not take it out. So being saying that, I would have to let it go into the end of the track and just let it ride out. If you can understand what I'm saying, for it to work right and it don't bother the ears. All right, so here we go. We ready to do it. Still did it, right? I was lunching. I'm like, hold on, man. Still delaying. I was going to get mad at the screen and everything, and I'm doing it. So y'all not great bait to hit me, but I'm getting ready to record, and then I'm going to just press the buttons and do some automation. Matter of fact, let's start off all wide. All right. So we're going to mute this now. check, check. All right, there we go. So there we go, man. We got the print. Last sound at the end. I don't know why I ain't moved that. Got a track sitting right here at the end of the track. And the sound and then the track my daughter pressed. Man, my daughter already played half of the sip. She won, right? But I ain't lying to you. I promise you. Two tracks, she really played the sound, man. All I did was clean it up. She did the idea for real. Solo these. Yeah, we gotta move them because I don't move the volume up on this track. That's why I got the play track. So we may move both of them down. All right, and now that we move both of them down, as you can see, I'm gonna show you the timing is off. See, you can see the timing off right there. You can see it on the clips. Look where the transients come in. Right, so what we gray do, we gray this master track. Once we master track, it's gonna be clean and crispy. You're gonna have two clean and crispy tracks. So we're gonna master track. First thing I do, snap it to the DAW one is gonna be snapped to the beat. The 6i6 one is the one that's gonna be in this instance it's early. Right. It's early, it's coming before that one. So it's working harder than it should be working, right? Basically, right? This one. I was going to say, should this snap like close enough? And then you're going to come have to get in and get it. Right here, I'm gonna have to hold control, but I see exactly where it go. Like, so I'm gonna hold control while I'm dragging, and then I'm gonna put it in place. All right, that's pretty close. So now, what I do is. These in. And now already got limiter right here in the British channel. And I'm gonna turn this limiter down and nothing first. And both of these tracks is output into this track. So we're gonna go each one separate first. We're gonna listen to the 6i6 first. Start paying attention to the correlation and see as the stereo start getting added in as I'm cutting on, you know, when I was what I was doing with the 6i6. See, you see how the stereo image changed? I wouldn't be able to do this with the DAW edit. So I did all this automating and this, and we're gonna blend both of these two together. Alright, so you see that, what I'm saying? So now we're gonna see the DAW mix. And they both good, they both great. See, but you will see. But you'll see the DAW mix, that was the automatic save happening. You will see the DAW mix still got all the good stereo feel in it, because remember what I told you, the aux is going back in here. My aux have automation on it. And we're gonna blend them together. And these already set at -3. And remember, we already know that they maxing out about the same anyway. So what we're gonna do, I'm gonna take my 6i6 one left 100%, 100, and I'm gonna take the DAW play back 100 right. And I got the British channel on here, and what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna show you the difference of the, I ain't gonna put nothing on here. I'm gonna volume match it. It should be volume match, we gonna see. I'm gonna volume match it, and I'm gonna change it to the oversampling. And I'm gonna show you for real. And actuality, and real all actuality, is making the plugin work harder just to turn it up a little more. It's good though, it's better. It's basically making it get to a point that probably another person couldn't get it to at ease, basically, with the setting of oversampling. Oversampling is doing exactly what it's saying. It's sampling the file over again. And it's probably 4 times in this plugin. So it's sampling it over, so it's going to be louder. So with this cutting it on, you're going to see all it do is turn it up a couple points, like a half a dB or something like that. So we go ahead, and you'll notice, like I say, I use the white channel throughout the whole edit. I use the black channel on my 2-bus, and on here, I'm going to use it on my master. This is going to be the master now, because I'm printing from these two, I'm going to print out my master. So what I do from here, I do 2 versions. I render a version and I print 1 more track. And so what I do, I create a track and then I say final print, and then this will come from the 6i6 again. And then I will render a track, render it. Render it through the plugins from the same track, and then I see which one is the best that I like better. And honestly, 9 times out of 10, I always like the print one better. The one I print and just render it out going through no plugins. I print it here, and then it don't gotta go through no plugins. It just get printed out. It seems to always work best to me. So I'd be great to play it with both of them. We're going to see where it's at. Ready to turn the British channel off and see, do we got any volume difference? No volume change, right? But you heard, you could hear it sound a little duller. Listen to the screen. Off and on, it's not louder, but it's opening up the lows and the top of the highs. It's smoothing out the highs, not opening them up. It's more smoothing out the highs with the British sound. Alright, so now we're gonna turn on the oversampling, and it work while it's playing too, but we just not gonna see it happen. You're gonna hear it happen. Now you can. I hope y'all can hear that. Like when I cut it on. Hold on. It make you feel a little more warm. Whatever they made the plug-in do, but. It ain't nothing you'll miss. You won't miss nothing if you never use it. But that's what I do. So I'm saying if you want to use the oversampling, which I do be wanting to use, right? Because that's it sound good. But this how you do it. I'm going to tell you how you do it in your edit, and it works out great. That's why they sell you both plugins. This the secret part. This the secret that nobody want to tell you, right? This is what you do, man. You run your edit. You pick one or the other. You go on white channel or you go on British channel for all your tracks. You either go on British channel or white channel for all your tracks. Whatever one you don't go with on your tracks, change that one to the oversampling. So I didn't use no British channels on my tracks. I only use it on my two bus and my, so let me go to my two bus. Go to this British channel, gonna tell me to do the same thing, right? So I only got two British channels in here, in this whole edit. Only got one on my two bus and one on this master fader here. And then they won't even conflict each other because this will only be solo when I'm mastering and that will only play in the edit. So they won't even get in the way of each other. But this way you get to get that ultimate warm. And you can see this thing been through, every track then been through a SSL. And there's never enough SSL. You can just keep running through it. You can see I got no settings touched, nothing touched, but it just warms it up again. And already been every track is going through a SSL. It already did it, and it's not stopped doing it. It's still doing it, man, track after track. So we're going to go ahead and play it again, and we're going to go ahead and get this a quick, dirty master with just this one plugin, and then our limiter right here, the stealth limiter. We're going to go with the stealth limiter. We're going completely SSL. This is all we have. We don't have nothing else. But we great master track. That's what we currently like. We currently like that, man. We ain't looking around for no extra stuff, no nothing. We great master with what we got. We stuck with just this, and we need a master done today. Can you get it done, sir? Yes, sir. I'm going to get it done right now. Here we go. But it's not dirty down there, because I told you what's going on down there. It's all clean music playing at the low. At my low, it's the music again playing low and clean. There you go, man. You know what I mean? The internet where I want it. Perceived value. I'm only in the green. My RMS is, I'm good with it going up to like 9, like right here, close to 8. I'm good. You know what I mean? That's what I'm looking for in my type, my style of music at this point in the track. So it's where I wanted to be, but I know this video been another one of my long ones. This one going on the album, but I gave you nothing but good information here today. So it's all well worth it, if, especially for newcomers, and if you're thinking about what interface to buy, and you asking my suggestion, it's definitely the 6i6. Not only because I use it, actually, I've been with Focusrite since I started recording, so you can't say I'm a little biased with it, right? You're going to be able to say I'm biased because I've been with them, but I always bought other interfaces too at the same time. Like I got I had two inboxes. I had the first version, and I got now the inbox. I got the inbox 2, and I got the M Audio. I had the Fast Track. I had Behringer, the Behringer mixer. I got the MPC Renaissance. We got the interface in it too. Whatever interface I had. I got a solo. I got the Focusrite solo too. Goddamn, there's so many interfaces, man. Oh, I had the satellite, the Mackie satellite. So, yeah, I've been through a lot of interfaces, but, and my first one that I bought was the Focusrite Sapphire, and it was a five wire interface. And when I first got it, everybody else that was recording around me was like, man, you tripping, why you get that? First off, because I ain't come back with Pro Tools. That was like, we ain't come back with Pro Tools, man, what you doing, man, you ain't get Pro Tools. At that point in time, it wasn't no, only recording softwares that I was knowing at my time was, which column was for beat making? Reason. That's when Reason first like hit. And I'm saying when I had my own studio equipment. Reason had first like hit. We was doing everything out of MPC. MPC for making the beats and stuff, I'm saying. You had Reason, then you had little what's the other one that they had that Reason had made first? That came out with track. I think what was it? Rebirth? Something like, I forgot what it was, but it was another propeller head software, right? And then you had, it was another one. Was it Beatcraft or something? That was like something that you can download and like do, start off doing beats for free. But they had a version they was selling, and it was for a person that was just getting into music, you could do something. And then Fruity Loops came, and it was Fruity Loops then. It wasn't FL Studio. Nothing. It was Fruity Loops. Like, I still call it Fruity Loops. Ain't going to get me to change from calling it Fruity Loops. That's Fruity Loops. So, yeah, Fruity Loops came out. And a lot of people that was using that, it started off, like, I see kids and stuff around my way was, like, using it. And they was making, like, that's when I first started hearing, like, them little snap beats and all that type of stuff. Like, when Fruity Loops hit. Everybody with this, because you naturally was going to end up with a snap beat, because everything went just to the grid. Then you just had people who perfected that grid and got so good with it that it became musical. So the people who made Fruity Loops, man, big ups to them, because they I ain't going to say they brought that, because like I say, the little joint Beatcraft was doing it too, and it could have been DAW before that, but I'm saying that I was able to get my hands on and use, and I tried them out. But I want to show some mini tips real quick. This is a big MIDI tip right here. So this is something that will make your workflow so much more easier with this using the MIDI, is the stretching things to fit in the time zone with MIDI. You know, it don't alter the sound of things. So we'll solo this real quick. And I'm going to show you. I'm going to play this. I'm going to mark this and play this for you. This our bass right here. This is the bass that's playing. Well, part of it. Alright, and then I'm going to show you how fast you can just turn this into, like how I did this. This is nothing but this double timed and stretched out. And all you would do is hold alt and drag it the same way you would do any other clips. I know other people might know this, but I know you might not know it, so I'm going to show it to you. And so, like I say, I'm going to take this all the way down to double time. Double time will be here because this is stretched out, so it really only supposed to be here to the ninth bar. So we're going to take it back down to double time. You got a popping effect going, but what I'm showing you is this is how you can get them rolls and all that stuff real quick with your drum beats. And you want to just change your tempo, you don't got to go mess with your tempo. You don't got to when you're messing with MIDI. When you're playing with the MIDI, you can go do all that in the clip. I mean, if that's what you want to do that, that's on you. You know what I'm saying? When you want to just go, you want to go turn your snare from going clap, 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 the clap, 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 or whatever you want to do, right? You want to do triple time, all you do is take the clip you already created and triple time it. It's that quick. You know what I mean? That was just a quick tip that I wanted to get out to everybody. Let me turn this option back on. Oh, sorry, I don't know why it ain't showing. Where is that? Oh, all right, there you go. All right. And, something else I wanted to say. Oh, yeah, and the step edit feature. Oh, this is cool, too, right? If you don't know about this, you hit this button right here, and then whatever note you, whatever you thinking in your head, as long as it's, from point to point, from beat to beat. So you thinking bing, boom, 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 you know what I mean? Whatever keys you thinking you want to play or something you practice, and you know you can't play that over and over, and you just want to get it down. Or say you could use this just to get it down. This the good thing about it, and then you can move it around. You can go play what you're trying to play while it's playing, and watch the cursor and see how close is it to them notes that you already put right here, right? You'll see how close it is to the notes that you already put right there from what you're playing, right? Out your MIDI keyboard. And then what you would just do, the notes that you know you play, and in the order that you play them in, don't worry about the time, but just hit them in the order that you play them in. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, how many keys you hit. If you hit 8 keys, you 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 7, 8, play all of them, each note, bang, bang, boom, boom, out. Don't worry about the timing or nothing. And what it will do, this step button will place each note on the next beat, and it will have each note right there. So where they was pressed at, I'm saying the keynote. So what's going to be good about that is you're going to be able to go and you still have the notes of everything you play, even if they're not in time where you want them. And then, like I say, you'll be able to go adjust them and put them where you want. And then you'll just have to set the length or whatever size beat you're using at the time. And then you can make the timing match by using the beat. So say you know that it's 2 beats apart, right, for each note. So you will want to make the notes 2 beat lengths. So each time you're pressing the note, it's going to be at 2 beats when the next note comes. So it's going to already, you might don't want the notes that long, but each starting point is going to be at the right point. I hope you can understand that, what I'm saying. But yeah, that was something I wanted to get to y'all with the MIDI. And basically, you can, man, if you're into making hip-hop tracks like me, rap tracks, I call my genre rockstar. Like, it's rap, go-go, rock, together all in one. So I got my own genre, man. It's rockstar, man. Ain't no limits to what I'm going to do. I ain't gonna call it nothing. Like, I don't make a trap or none of that. Like, you might say it's something closer. You might hear something in there, but I don't, you know what I mean? I ain't gonna say I make trap or nothing. I ain't gonna say I use nothing from trap style, but I ain't gonna call my music trap or none of that. But my music rocks though, man. Like, ain't no telling where my next song gonna go. That's what I'm saying. Like, tomorrow I might have a whole new idea, and you be like, what? That joint ain't nothing like the last. Yeah, man, my music rocks the music, man. You know what I mean? So that's pretty much it, man. Thanks for tuning into the tutorial. I know this was a long one, but hopefully it was a plentiful one. So, man, tune into the next one. Your boy Obey, who say, what's up, Regular Production. Signing out, man. Peace.